What is going on, world? Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Real Estate Evolve podcast. I am your host, Kenyon Hunter, leader of Evolution Ave Group at KW, real estate entrepreneur, motivator, and purveyor of all things cool. Well, 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 do I have a treat for y'all today. Are y'all ready for a great show? I told y'all I was going to bring you quality guests. Remember, Les Brown said, only quality people. You only associate yourself with only quality people. So, I have a quality person here, a real quality person. I'm just going to let you know who she is, and I'm going to let her do the rest. Please welcome Javada Hill.
Thank you.
What's up, Javada?
How you doing?
I'm doing well. How you feeling?
I'm feeling great.
Awesome. Well, look, thank you so much for being on the show. Appreciate it. We got a great show planned for the people today, right? We're going to share some knowledge. Real treat for your for our real estate professionals, but also, as you know, this is not just a real estate podcast. This is a life podcast. This is a mindset and personal growth podcast. And we're here to spread our gift. And our gift is we're helping people, making people better, making the world better, making society better, however you want to put it. But let's just get into this. Javada, tell us about you. Where are you from?
I'm from Upper Darby, the class of 2009.
Okay, 2009.
I know.
High school 2009?
Yes. Darby High School. Okay, count right. It up.
I ain't going to tell you. Nah, because I'm going to have to count up my... Nah, I ain't even going to get into
it's
that.
Okay, it's okay.
All right, tell us about background, career.
I'm Temple Made. I started at Temple's marketing program at 1515 and Market. I told Barbara Korn, she was like the leader of the real estate department. Oh, yeah, you know Barbara.
Yeah.
Okay. I told her I was working in that student, Temple student worker job, and I was like, no, I need a new internship. I was sick of that place. And then she put me in contact with Brian Capone, and it kind of just like aligned that he was looking for an intern and I was looking for an internship, and then that's how I got at 530 Walnut.
Okay. Walnut. So tell me, what shifted you to real estate, though? What was the essence that brought you to real estate?
I was always reading those Rich Dad, Poor Dad books. I was in a marketing class or like a stock market class at Upper Darby, and I was just, into that, lifestyle. So I went to Temple for marketing, and then now I use, my marketing crafts to elevate my real estate business.
Gotcha. All right. So let's get into personal facts, hobbies, and everything you want the public to know or what they should know about Javada Hill.
Personal facts. I coached high school girls basketball.
Okay. What position you played?
I played the center.
Center? Mm. How tall are you?
5'7".
Okay. All right. Just putting in work down there. Who's your favorite player? Growing up.
My best friend, Dior.
Your best friend? No NBA star? Or WNBA star? What's your favorite player?
Can I say the team, not the player?
Was it the Sixers? Shout out to the 76ers. Yes. About to close out the first round and move on to the next round. Shout out to the Sixers. Y'all go. Philly, stand up.
I like the Celtics because of their wood
pattern. The parquet floors?
Yeah.
What? Okay. That sounds like something that would come from a real estate entrepreneur, right? All right. That's what's up.
And AI.
I gotta love AI. It's probably, I'm a lifelong Michael Jordan fan, but however, AI is right up there as one of my favorite players. So tell us about, this is your opportunity. Plug the brand, plug the work, plug the service that you provide right now. I wish you would come over to Red, but I know that's not what you're about to talk about.
All right. Oh, my God.
Talk about it.
Did you watch the Beyonce Homecoming?
No.
I feel like every time I walk into my office, I feel like I'm walking into my homecoming.
All right.
So she went over the culture of the HBCUs, and you ever been to a homecoming for Howard and stuff?
Yeah, I went to Morgan State.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Didn't know that.
Yeah.
So you know how like homecomings
Greensboro,
are.
Then I went to Morgan State. So yeah, I know. Trust me.
Yeah. So that's the center of her 2-hour presentation. But yeah, like imagine having that feeling that you got the step show and everyone's killing it. Like, you know how you, that feeling you got.
Yeah, that's how you feel when you walk in.
To 530 Walnut.
Okay, all right. 530 Walnut, I will say I've had a couple settlements there. That is a dynamic office, dynamic location. A lot of just busyness and moving around going on in there. So much respect to 530 Walnut. Much respect. So tell us about you know, real estate. Tell us about your brand, you know, what you focus on.
I like West Philly.
Okay.
I like Cobbs Creek. They're close to home, and you know they're close to home, so it was easy for me to get to, you know, over there 10, 15 minutes. So I just start farming that section of the city, and I started with like Winfield, Overbrook, 1-on-1-3-9. Just fixing on that coast of like that Cobbs Creek, Baltimore Ave, and then I just start flipping them to investors.
Okay, is that your main? Is your clients mostly investors? Are your clients mostly investors?
My clients are mostly investors and first-time home buyers, and so like 40%
investors. 40%
investors.
All right. We love about first-time home buyers. I talked about that in an episode recently. Let me see. I want to know if you share the same sentiments I have with first-time home buyers.
I don't. I'd rather take me a senior citizen.
Really?
Yes.
Why?
Because they don't do the technology. They don't text me at night. You know, it's usually a phone call. Most of the seniors are real. They're just patient and smooth and calm going people. So I hunt for that.
My very first real estate transaction in New Jersey was senior citizens in a 55 and over. And they were such a great couple. I mean, it was easy. But I do like first-time home buyers. I know a lot of people want to chase like the big markets, the luxury markets. But what I do like about first-time home buyers is I feel like probably like senior citizens too, because they are making a transition in life typically if they're buying. First-time home buyers, that's the American dream, right? That they at least is perceived to be. And I do enjoy being a part of that life change and the happiness that comes out of it with first-time home buyers. But I also understand that the consumer mind, client mind, doesn't always know what we put into this business, right? So I do get it. Some of the first-time home buyers, they're very well-educated, right? Well, there's a lot of data out there for them to collect, right? So sometimes they come to us telling us things that, you know, we should be showing them. Like sometimes I'll have a buyer, a client, tell me what to offer on the house, right? Which is always interesting to me that they don't ask me, what should we offer? They say, well, this is what I want to offer. And I'm wondering why, where they got that from, right? But it's because I don't think that happened a lot back in the day, right? Where it happens now because of all the data, right? Because, you know, Z is telling them what their Z estimate is, right? So you got things like that where they can feel like they have that knowledge and it you know, they're not in the market every day, right? So it's kind of like telling your attorney, you know, how to proceed with the case. You wouldn't do that.
I think buying real estate brings out a different emotion in you that you don't necessarily get to experience every day, the fear, the anxiety, the worry. And how it's handled for me in a later age, it's more passive, like it's a more calming conversation. But you definitely have to set the expectations for your clients, you know, going forward, which will mitigate some of the stress or heartache.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So we're going to move on to kind of the treat that I have and we have for the real estate professional. So Javada wants to discuss the success of direct marketing campaigns. Now, I'm curious to know about this because I'll be honest, I don't, that's not one of my methods of marketing, but I have heard so much about it. So I'm very curious about this. So I would suggest that you get out your iPhone notes or if you're using an Android, get those notes. I'm sure they have a note application on them, on those joints too.
Do that.
you know, we want to talk about that. We're going to get into, you know, how Javada does it, why she believes in it. She's going to share some gems, drop some knowledge, and, you know, we're going to take it from there. So without further ado, Javada, I'm opening the stage to you.
Tell me what you feel when you open up that.
What I feel when I open it or what I feel right now?
When you open it up.
All right. Open it up. Somebody's giving me a card.
I handed him one of my direct marketing campaigns.
Oh. Let me look at this. So it doesn't feel like some cheap little flimsy, you know, I'm going to throw this away. It feels like quality, for one. This isn't printer paper, right? It's thicker stock, colorful, information. Hi, my name is Javada Hill, and the spring market is here. I have cash buyers looking for multifamily, residential, and lots in Philadelphia, aiming to spend up to $10 million. Please reach out if you or someone you know is interested in selling. Call me. I'm easy to talk to.
Which is handwritten.
Handwritten. I see that. Cash for multifamily, residential, and lots. Any price, any condition. If you are going through a divorce, inherited a property, facing foreclosure, relocating, lost a job, tired of renters, want a lump sum of cash, just want to get rid of it, or you have unaffordable taxes, welcome to New Jersey. you should call Javada Hill. I like this. So this is something I have not seen.
Give me the key part. All right, guys.
Then she has the business card in here with the pen. Wait a minute. We're gonna talk about this penny. I think we've talked about this before,
but
me and you.
What does it say?
And it says, you're worth every penny.
There you go.
And she has a penny in the trifold. So we got to talk about this. Tell me about this.
No, this is a killer.
Tell me about this. Tell me about it. I want to hear about
it. This is a killer.
I want to know about it, and I know aspiring minds want to know.
No, so I got the cardboard paper from Michaels. They had a great sale. And then I make everything on Canva, and I spaced it out. And then we got the printer, so I just printed. I took a weekend and just printed it out. And it's a trifold, so every section has like a different little piece that draws them, and then the handwritten little sexy marks, you know, bring people in.
I love it.
So you put your business card on it, you know, you just funk it up a bit.
So what made you think of that? I've never seen a marketing piece like that before.
So, you know how you got like the first draft, this is like the 10th draft.
So this was the one you had at first?
This is the original.
Okay, okay.
So that's just a stamp, and it still has the business card and the washi tape. You know, it's not.
Gotcha.
It's out of the
Your hair was different out of it. You had the.
I know, I had the little fro.
Okay, little fro.
And it's hot outside.
You're worth every penny.
Right, so then you transitioned that over to here with like a little bit more wording and, you know, stuff like that, and then people are hooked.
Okay. I dig the slogan, you work for every penny. So you old school with it. You go to the bank and get a roll of pennies.
I told you who I like. I like my grandmoms, you know. I like my landlords of tenants. You know, just give me a cash deal and we keep it moving. So that's who like appreciates for me the craftsmanship that goes into it. One of my favorite ones is I sent this "You're Worth Every Penny" campaign to this landlord. I don't even think I sent it to his property, to his investment property. And then he called me and he was like, "Hey, I'm gonna take one of your pennies and put it in my retirement fund." And then, he listed like this like $500,000 sale with me like 3 weeks later. But it was on Temple's campus.
Okay.
So I felt like I went to Temple for marketing and then I ended up like through marketing from a decent lead.
So could you share how much do you think you spend on each one of those? Is this your hand power putting these together? Okay.
Well, like I do the Every Door direct mail.
Okay.
So like I use this online company like 55 Printing that ships in bulk for cheap, maybe like $1,000 for like 200 or maybe less. quality, you know, printing work and, you know, pick a section. Have you used that before?
I haven't used it. I have no direct marketing experience. I haven't done any direct mail. I've contemplated it, but what happens is I think of all these, like, I, you know, I read and go to masterminds, and I think about different you know, avenues to prospect and do that, but I never ever really think about direct mail. And then when I have thought about it, I feel like I always get so tied up that I never get around to it. But
do you do those reminder magazines? American Lifestyle?
I have not gotten to print. That's why I was so interested in listening to you today and tell us about this. You're going to teach me and you're going to teach the listeners about this, because you know, I know there are agents that do focus heavy on direct mail, and you know, whether it's obtaining listings, whether it's just sold, whether it's, you know, whatever it is, they it's a very effective way to get business, right? That's the thing. Yeah. I guess the argument would be, in this technological online world we live in, there'd probably be a lot of agents that may argue direct marketing.
I think one of the things that I heard early on was you get the listings, you last. So I just kept focusing on listings.
Right.
And I did that yellow letter campaign that got me, you know, one early on, started in 2013. And I was, I got scared.
Okay.
I got scared. I didn't know what I was going to do with it. I was like, oh, it works. Thank you.
And it worked.
So, and then I think from that one, I'm just now realizing like who the person that called was. Like, okay. It was just like a 60-year-old person that was trying to sell like their grandma's home. So I think initially that connection was that was like the first person that called. So then I was like, oh, maybe that's my target market.
Okay. So tell me, what would you tell a new real estate agent? What would you tell them would be, you know, direct marketing campaigns 101? How would you explain that? Like, from start to this is your, you know, creating your product to getting it out there, rename the services you use, because I'm sure that went over, some people might have missed that. And then, like, you know, ideally, what kind of return are you seeing?
I start on public records, and I search through the age bracket that I like in the section that I want to aim for. And sometimes I look for expires or withdrawals during a certain age time frame, and I'll send for that and just start hunting and find it out whoever I get back. I do need to record some more of my return. But this You're Worth Every Penny campaign has, in the past four weeks, have gotten me two seller leads.
Two seller leads, okay. Got you. And how many did you send out, do you think?
I send out 20 a day.
20 of those go out a day? Automatically, though. Through what services?
Berkshire.
Okay. But you mentioned something earlier. You mentioned two different services earlier that you
The printing company?
The printing companies.
55printing.com.
Okay. Gotcha.
Is cheap.
Oh, that's how you create that?
No. This is Manpower.
That's from Canva?
Yep. Okay. I created the platform on Canva.
Gotcha. Yeah, I use Canva too for some general.
But I didn't have someone like folding it. You know, that's what.
You did it all yourself?
Yeah, I did that.
Need an assistant. Yeah. How you feel about assistant? Would that be your next hire?
Yeah.
Yeah. To get to that point.
And then I'm thinking about my seniors. I feel like my helpers would be my seniors to
go get them to work on your squad.
Because I feel like, I mean, that's like my target market. That's my community. That's definitely like my senior community. And what I'm seeing is that they get to a certain age and they want something to do. And they'll start to call me and say, hey, Javada, you know, you got any you know, I just want a little something to do during the day. You got any, you know, thing for me, anything? I'd be like, damn, like, all right.
That's actually a good idea. That's a good idea. Because when you think about a solid assistant, somebody that really would value your work, obviously a client.
They know me already. I took them through the, you know, a crazy part of their life, and I held their hand the whole way.
Right, right.
Like, we're connected.
Yeah, no doubt. No doubt. So, who introduced you to direct marketing? I mean, what made you start doing direct marketing? Because, I mean, when you first get into the game, you've been in the game since when?
2013.
When you first get into the real estate game, a million and one people are calling you, emailing you, or just, you know, look, I'm sure Berkshire, just like KW, just like Remax, Caldwell, everybody has their different strategies, right?
Mm-hmm.
Marketing strategies and what they recommend, whether you're using dollar systems, whether you're doing marketing, whether you're door knocking, whether you're buying leads or, you know, however you decide to do it, right? So what brought you to the direct marketing campaigns?
The Zillow leads wasn't really working out.
So you tried Zillow?
Yeah, we tried Zillow. I do the American Lifestyle magazines.
Ads?
No, like the magazine.
What do you do? What do you mean? What do you do with
you
it?
You got like a American Lifestyle company that comes and they give you your A clients. Monthly magazines, which like your face on.
Oh, so it's like a branded magazine for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Got you.
And I like the listings. So, and I like Michaels. Like I was a Girl Scout, so I do all that crafty stuff.
So you create stuff.
It gives me peace, and I do that, and then I watch a basketball game.
All right. We're in the world to create. That's what we do. All right. I got you.
It gives me joy.
Gives you joy.
I like putting the colors together, and that kind of is like. What inspires me, I like, you know, spring colors. So I want to see me.
So
like
you
a
like
spring
putting these together,
piece.
Right? So you like putting these together. That's
oh,
like
I like it.
That's
a joy. Right, I got another one for you.
All right, let me see. All right, let me see this one. Can I open it?
Yeah.
All right. Because you sealed it. You hear that? The mic is picking that up.
That's an iconic sound.
Iconic. Iconic. Ah, okay. So we got a little bit more. Got the spring vibes going on this one too. Business card attached to this. Hi, my name is Javada Hill. I'm your local realtor with Berkshire Hathaway, providing quality service and attention. Cash flow is no problem. Let's talk about your real estate needs today. So have you been doing this direct mail since 2013? What percentage of your business comes from this, you think? I like that too.
Thank you.
Yeah, what percentage?
This is too much manpower.
You gotta hire an assistant.
No, because then you got or stripped.
You went to Temple, college interns. Yeah. Are we allowed to hire interns? Oh, y'all, I know Jersey has a rule about that, but I don't know if PA, can y'all hire
maybe.
An intern?
I think so.
You have to be paid?
I don't think
There's
so.
There's some rules behind
maybe
it.
Maybe
anyway.
Some like college credit.
Yeah, you know what? I do know people that belong to business programs that end up working at real estate companies. So, I mean, there's probably some rule around it, but hey, you got to learn the business from the ground up, right?
Right.
Right? Okay, cool. What else would you like to add about direct marketing campaigns and how they work and what agents should know and do and how to take action?
Oh, yeah. Focus on a section of the city.
Mm-hmm. Or town. Mm-hmm. You know, here in Jersey, we're recording in Jersey today. I had to get Javada to step over the river. She didn't want to. People from Philadelphia
don't want to.
Never want to come across the bridge.
I'm
closer to Tennessee than half of y'all are where y'all live.
Oh,
at.
Maybe. The train was clean.
I told you.
You didn't tell me that.
Well,
I didn't know what to expect.
I told you it was easy.
Yeah, you told me it was easy, and it definitely was. It felt like not walking distance, but it wasn't bad.
Yeah, you landed in the great town of Collingswood.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
Home
of BYOBs and mom and pop restaurants and good food, the lumber yard.
Yeah, it was shaky initially.
Groove Ground Coffee Shop. Shout out to Groove Ground. I work from there a lot. Great day to be at Groove Ground, a day outside. But all right. So what would you say? Like, what would you, how can they take, how can people take action? Especially for our new agents or agents that are not using direct marketing campaigns today.
Oh,
what would you tell them? What's
I would say you
make it compelling for them.
It's quite simple.
Simple is good.
Yeah. Make it personal. make it like really personal. Even if you think that your handwriting is disgusting, like there's mm-hmm. people out there that a seller might agree that, oh, his handwriting is as disgusting as mine is, so maybe we'll relate. And I just automatically
maybe
said it.
Yeah, because my chicken scratch, you would think I'm a doctor the way
right?
I write.
Yeah, so don't let that stop you from, you know, doing it. And I definitely pay people to do like handwritten service. Because right. I looked at those, there's like online services that will do the handwritten letter for you for like a dollar a card, maybe. More like $3 a card.
They copy your signature?
They should be.
I mean, yeah. So I'm like, somebody I know might get them.
Like,
I know.
No, it's like a computer generated thing.
Okay,
like they
so you
do
write
it
once and then they.
I don't know if they copy or I don't know if they copy your signature, which will make a big difference. Or do they have like cursive handwriting letters that make it look really human?
Okay, I got you. Yeah, my handwriting has gotten worse as I got older. I don't know why. Is it from, do you think it's from like moving our fingers on cell phones so much? I just don't have the patience to write. That's my problem.
So you're saying that your handwriting got worse over time?
Yeah.
Huh. Like, well, I stopped writing?
I mean, do we ever really stop? So we got to sign something.
But you're just citing. That's not writing.
I don't write much. I don't handwrite anything.
So
maybe that's why.
Do you handwrite your goals out? Do you handwrite?
No, I don't know. I type them.
I think that makes a difference. I think the way that it feels on the paper and from like correlation from your eyes to your hands, that's a connection.
It
so,
is.
So like using that muscle, I think definitely they tell write everything down or
yeah I don't like writing but I you know what but that is true. They do say that when you write it down it means it. And but see, I thought in the new age writing down could be typing it in your notes.
Are you the new age?
I like being the new. I can't be new. I mean, I graduated well before 2009 but I'm still somewhat new.
Yeah, and you know how sometimes you see those like new construction buildings and they're like then you go and see something in Germantown
classic.
Or Westwood, that classic.
Mm-hmm.
I'm definitely, you know,
writing
classic.
So you like writing? Yeah.
What do you feel about some of those new constructions, like buildings compared to the classic? Like, what is your type?
I do have so I like modern, but I also like character. So I like a mix of modern and character. So new construction is cool. Like, so I am a little bit of a technology, futuristic vibe kind of guy. So some of the new construction I dig. What I don't dig is if it's just, see, it's hard to say because I think that properties are something you got to feel more than you really see. Does that make sense? So what I mean by that is, you know, you can go in a brand new construction in the middle of Queens Village and, you know, $1.2 million and inside is just no character, right? But I think there's some people that do new construction, but they somehow either maintain or they just capture some unique character in the building. And that's what I dig that. Like, I love when people make warehouses into those cool lofts.
Oh, I love them.
I love that.
I love that.
I don't know if I like when you knock something down and just build this very generic new age design, and sometimes they just do too much, where I just like a little bit of character, which is why you know, I used to be a big city dweller, right? I love the cities. I always said that I would never leave the city, and then children came and I left the city. But when I did leave the city, what I did come to appreciate was now I love your main street environments, right? So I love towns that have a main street environment that have, you know, classic architecture but modern interiors or modern insides. That's what I like. That's what I dig. Like
classic exterior and
classic
modern
exterior.
Interior.
Yeah. So I like your Victorians. I like your contemporary homes. I like your row homes or brownstones, depending on where you are, right? I like those. But then I like when you walk in and I like the open concept and I like the modern vibes, but still leave some character. Give me some exposed brick. Give me some, you know, awesome moldings. Give me some, you know, a little bit of columns here and there. Give me some, you know, unique floors. You know, not nothing just cookie cutter. I don't want to walk in as if I'm walking straight into Home Depot and just walking down the aisle seeing the flooring and the fixtures. I don't want to see that. I want to see something unique. Make every house unique. So I appreciate the contractors and the builders that are doing, like, cool stuff, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah, all right, classic. So Javada Hill is, she's a classic girl. You know what I'm saying? She likes
it
classic.
I like it. I think I like it old on the outside and old on the inside.
Okay. Yeah. You like? Oh, you like? So you like the? You're not into the stainless steel. You're not into.
I mean,
the,
I like that. I feel like that place that you were picturing was like Red Development, or they do that in like Fishtown.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, and I still feel like on the inside it could be cold.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like, it can be. Sometimes they can. Like, it's just, they build and it's just like, all right. And then the inside is just,
it's
square.
It's groovy.
It's
square. I just feel like it could be temporary. Like, I would want to spend my winters in my, like.
You know who does a nice mix of that? Do you watch Windy City Rehab?
Not yet.
You got to watch Windy City Rehab. Her name is Allison Victoria, brunette.
Is he a big girl guy?
No. It's a woman.
And she got a guy partner?
Yeah, he's not a big dude, though. You're thinking about that one in the country, I think. This one's in Chicago.
Okay.
Allison Victoria, I think that's her Instagram.
All right.
But look her up. She buys, you know, Chicago brownstones. And then, but she, obviously, she modernizes. I mean, she's buying them for like 7, 8, 1.2. She's buying them for high purchase prices. But Chicago's market does demand that. And then she puts a lot of modern with a nice splash of character in her rehabs. So check it out. I think you would like it.
I think we're talking about the same thing, and it's on HGTV.
HG or Bravo, one of them. I get them mixed up
sometimes. I think that you're thinking about the girl, and I'm thinking about the guy. Because
it's Allison. I'm pretty sure it's Allison.
Isn't she short?
Allison Victoria. You never saw it?
I saw it.
Look, that's her right there.
Yeah, I saw that. And then go to the regular page and show the guy.
Well, the guy she worked with, her partner, is, I think it's, no, not
brother?
This guy. No, it's not. It's her show.
Yeah.
It's really, she's the star. Like, she's the main person. I'm trying to find a dude. Like, her construction manager, I don't even see him. I think it's this guy. It's that guy. He handles the construction side of it.
Yeah.
But you're thinking of something else, I think. You're thinking of the... There is a show where it's like a brother and sister combo.
No,
it's
definitely her.
Okay.
Yep, it's definitely her. But so it's interesting because I will remember the guy and you remember the girl. HG did a good job on that.
She's a star.
Yeah, so. But he's attractive.
That dude, you like that beard? He got the Philly ball beard, huh?
I like him big. Hefty.
That's a good.
Yep, yeah. Sure did.
Yep, that's a good show. So this the show? This the right one?
Yep, it's the right one.
So
you like, would remember her.
Why would I remember
her? She's
look
cute.
At like look at that house. Look
I
at that.
Know, I know. That's pretty.
That's vibes. Look at the vibes. That's vibes.
Yeah.
Like the way
like
she mixes in.
But that doesn't seem like a house you want to have Christmas in. I like
that. You don't think so?
Not with those velvet chairs. No one's sitting.
Yeah.
You know, that's like a party house.
What's wrong with that?
Until it's time to go to bed.
That's what they want, the party house. That's what they want. You know, we're going to move into a real next section. I'm going to tell you what. I was excited about discussing this. So, when I first met Javada, shout out to Genevieve, Gigi.
Hey.
We went out and we took some pictures. We broke bread as fellow agents and friends. And we had a good time. And then... was it the next day or a couple days later, Javada sends out a group text and she says, I am the possibility of. And I was, and it was like, what are you the possibility of? And it comes out. And we all had to, you know, say, I am the possibility of.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was so powerful. Starting your day saying, it's basically an affirmation that you're making. But it gets you going when you make those affirmations, right? How'd you come up with that? Like, what's the origin of I'm the possibility of?
Landmark. It's a professional development course at 8th and Market. And it just maintains your mindset. Like, the people around you are, like, heavy hitters. And you create the context. Like, you know how you are word and you just focus on, you know, whatever you say is... what you going to do. So my group would just send out, you know, I am the possibility of adventure and well-being. And then for that day, you just Hey, you like that one?
I do like it a lot.
So in that day, just step into that, to that context, and just make sure that everything that around you is, I had an adventure in coming over here, you know? Yeah. So that's what I'm,
you're the possibility of adventure today?
Yeah. Okay. And I had quality time with you, and that was well-being.
Yeah. So listen, here's a couple from our first text chain. I am the possibility of incredible leadership. I am the possibility of powerful communication and calmness and strength. I am the possibility of being the creative director of my life. I am the possibility and the epitome of creating my life by design. I am the possibility of creativity and productivity and organization. Let me see another one from Javada. I am the possibility of being clear, present, real, connected, and heart directed. Just to name a few. Just to name a few. So I think what we should task our listeners with, and everybody out there, is every morning you should make your affirmation. Think about what you're the possibility of. Like, so today you are the possibility of adventure
and well-being
and well-being
and playful connection.
Today I am the possibility of empowering people through this podcast and shifting or redirecting someone's life for the better.
And what does that look like for you in your like everyday life?
So one thing that I pray for every day is that somehow, some way, I serve. I want to serve as many people as possible. However, if I only serve one person, I'm fine with that, as long as it changed their life or it made their life better in one way or form. For instance, obviously, you know, we're social media friends. I drop my daily dose of vitamin K every day. That daily dose is going to be something for somebody somewhere that's going to either help them make a decision. Maybe it changes their mindset for that day. Maybe
it gives me encouragement.
Encouragement. I'm just trying to, you know, help somebody in some way every single day. That's all I want to do. And I think that's part of, you know, empowerment, right? And if I had to, I think I did talk about this recently, but, you know, real estate is an amazing platform because it puts you in a position to communicate with people every single day in every single way. And, you know, I love being a real estate entrepreneur. However, I'm hoping that, you know, it's a platform to do more with helping and serving people, right? Because on the foundation of it, real estate, how do we help people? We help people buy, sell, invest, rent homes. We help people find home, whether it's for residential or commercial. We help people do that. That's just the base. That's just one part of it, right? But the bigger picture for me as a real estate entrepreneur is real estate is my platform and my vehicle to reach people and help people. Whether I'm helping people buy, sell, invest, and yeah, fulfill their American dream or whatever dream they have, whether I'm helping people build wealth, that's one side of it. But the other side of it is you're helping people move on to new chapters of their life, whether they're getting married, maybe they're getting divorced,
yeah,
maybe they're having children, or maybe their children are leaving the house and they're empty nesters. Maybe it's just starting a new life in a new city or a new town. There's so many things you can do, but I'm also looking to touch, you know, real estate agents and teach them how to be better at this world that we're in and work good with my partners, my mortgage partners, my title partners, my insurance partners.
Amen.
My builders, you know, contractors, plumbers, mechanics, electricians, handymen. I mean, look, we have our web of contacts and partnerships and client bases can extend, you know,
I got
far
that
out. But I also just want to help people be better, right? Better at everything. I want to help people, you know, take that jump, you know, take the leap of faith and follow their dreams, right? Because I think that what happens is, and I'm just taking this from my own experience, right?
I like what you said about how you use real estate as a platform to show your own personal crafts. So, like how you have these podcasts, like we just sitting here having a conversation. Yeah. Like it's but you created it through real estate. So I think that is that's definitely something like the nice, like designers, like they created that.
They created it, right?
Create something through whatever platform that you're using through this recent project. I think I was telling you about it. It's like my work for the community mm-hmm. that I focus on, West Philly, and I've been highlighting like legendary like creative creators in West Philadelphia.
Right.
I did Mark Republic, and I just had a conversation with him at his barbershop and just was like, how was it for you when you bought your property, mm-hmm. like going through every section of, you know, the emotional stance. So in turn, it will help, you know, other first time home buyers that want to get involved but don't know what to expect. So right. here's your peer and ask him and then listen to him and then, you know, connect with him to figure out, you know, just to get a little insight and encouragement. So I did, this is older guy, like my mom bought her wedding dress off of him and I interviewed him. Check my story.
You interviewed him?
Yeah, I interviewed him. He's been on like 52nd Street for like 50 years.
Okay.
Oh,
I did see that. I saw that.
Yeah,
I saw that.
Legendary.
Yeah, I did
so
see that.
So he talks about the community,
right.
And what he sees for like the commercial real estate of mm-hmm. the community and people just coming in, just buying, you know, creating the same type of stores. And he thought that the 52nd Street was going to be equivalent to Germantown Ave, like the, you know, booming businesses, but it didn't turn out like that.
Right.
And how he wants to provide quality stores to like the black market.
Okay.
So he said like most of our stores are not as quality. I thought of Easy Pickings.
Sure.
And like Rainbows.
Right.
The ones
that are over there.
Yeah, like you know those clothing stores of female, they was like trash.
Right, but, it's low end, yeah.
But he's creating more of the quality for okay. our community. And that was like his story that he wanted to share for it.
Man, I love that.
So, yeah, it's a nice little project.
So one of my morning affirmations or asks of God is always to help me revitalize cities and towns. That's like a dream of mine, right? So I ask for that every day, to be in that position to revitalize the town. So I just respect it. I love it. I mean, I think there's, you know, even in some of the roughest towns, like I grew up in Trenton, and I just feel like there's so much beauty. Like, you ever get a chance, go to like the Mill Hill section of Trenton, if you're ever in Trenton. I don't know if you're ever going to be in Trenton. You don't like leaving Philadelphia, so you probably never going to be in Trenton. But like the Mill Hill section. It's just a beautiful part of the city. Or go around Hiltonia, around Cadwater Park in Trenton. Okay. And you'll see things that most people don't picture about the city. You know, I mean, I'm from North Trenton, so I love riding up and down the boulevard. I got so many memories of the summers, windows down, Nas playing, whatever. I love the way the hood looked, but I would love to revamp it. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes I think people get the wrong impression, too, of why are you going to put money into these cities if people don't care about it? Well, also, I do think that to a certain extent, if you have better surroundings or a better looking environment, maybe you have something to care about.
I think it's about creating the culture for mm-hmm. the community. Like yeah. you, developers, designers have the ability to create a culture. And I think that you definitely can, you know, manipulate and shift the culture of a community.
Yeah, 100%. And you know, like I said, I think too, it's not cool to be dirty, and it's not cool to be in like in a very impoverished surrounding. So if you make something better and you can shift the culture where people actually appreciate the surroundings, then, you know, perhaps people will take care of it. But you got to shift the culture a little bit, right?
I like it.
Shift the culture. So I'm the possibility of, right? So I think that can affect people in such a powerful way if they really make that a morning exercise to do that, right?
Yeah, when and be we held it, accountable for it. Like, that's yeah. what I've seen, like, recently. Like, I got a coach, and Javada, you're going to say you're going to have these out by a certain date. They're going to be out by a certain date.
Right.
And what we going to do to make sure that you get this done?
Right.
So that's, like, helped me stay on a structure. Buffini would talk about the calls, notes, and Popeyes. Like, I'll do like a Popeye in the spring, maybe with a bouquet of flowers. Or maybe just like a tulip and call it a day. And maybe like a little handwritten note. And then that's my touch for that month. So, and they think it's so personal. You could just be, you got a showing. You can just, you know, I'm going to pop over to, you know, my past client's house, give them some FaceTime and get out of there.
Right. You know what I really like about the I'm Impossibility series or that affirmation is that at the end of the day, the only thing that matters is what you say about yourself. I think we're in this world where people, and it's clear from social media, people really do take heed to what other people think and say about them. But when you're affirming something about yourself, then that's what you should, you know, program your mind to believe and not really care about what others say. So I think that that's what's so powerful about making that that affirmation, that and telling yourself what you're the possibility of.
Yeah, and I get it that it's hard to get through some of those emotions of like, you know, what people say, like what's the thought, am I doing okay, comparison is a thief of joy, and you gotta continue to reset. Like sometimes I might need a power nap, like I just gotta reset myself and just keep starting yourself off on a strong note.
Oh, absolutely, 100%. I think that, you know, if it was easy to be positive and optimistic every day,
it's not.
I mean, you really have to, you know, you really have to train your mind for those things. And then you really have to become consistent.
And that's why I'm happy that you're in my life.
Thank you.
Yeah, because our group chat is consistent. And sometimes when I'm not feeling it, and then I get your text, I'll be like, damn, all right, come on, Jay, let's rock and roll. And so I do appreciate, you know, just you hitting me up and helping me start off, because sometimes, you know, it's hard out here for a pimp.
It is hard out here for a pimp. So we got to, you know, and that's what I'm saying. This is why, you know, I think that my gift and my purpose here is to empower people, to enlighten people, to motivate people. I really do. I think that being great in sales and real estate and having success in so many different things and avenues of my life, I really do feel like if I can touch people every day in a great way and make it better, it's great. So I'm glad that I can be a part of your life. I'm glad you're a part of my life, because the affirmation of I Am a Possibility has affected my life in a great way, right? Because I make those affirmations every day. Even when we forget to text each other every day.
Yeah, I
make
it.
I make affirmations,
I'm texting
though.
Someone.
Yeah, I make those affirmations to myself.
You can
and I tell
call
myself.
Me.
Yeah, I will. I'm gonna call it when I can't. Text is always easy.
I want to hear your voice.
You like to hear my voice?
Yeah, I want to hear your voice.
They say I should be on the radio.
So that kind of sounds like what inspires you, and that feels like that kind of like what inspires like the future generation. Like,
absolutely.
I like creating something nice that you can look at.
yeah, I agree.
And if it works, you know, like, and then create it on like a larger scale.
I can dig it. Well, I hope that everybody now will start tomorrow. That's the task. We're going to task all that. Start tomorrow.
No, why tomorrow? That's too late.
So
that's
you,
like 16 hours.
So they should say start today, this
right
afternoon.
Now. Tell, like, what is holding you back from starting?
So after you listen to this podcast, you heard Javada. After you listen to this podcast, make your affirmation. Tell yourself, I am the possibility of. And you make that, and then that's how you're going to carry out your day. Think about that.
What do you want to be acknowledged for? Have you heard that before?
No.
All right. So one day, Mimi, she called me up, and she asked me, like, what do I want to be acknowledged for? And I was like, damn, I never heard that before. I don't know. Like, I don't know. And I was thinking, and I was like, had on sweatpants, like
right,
some
right.
boots, like just real grungy, like I just wasn't feeling it, and then I dressed up.
All right.
And then I was like, yeah, I just wanted to be acknowledged for, you know, showing out.
All right.
Because I wasn't feeling it. And then I flipped that script real quick. And was like, come on, Jay.
Just want to be acknowledged for showing out. Or showing up.
Yeah, for showing up.
Showing up. What do I want to be acknowledged for? In life?
Yeah, anything.
You know. I'm always the happiest moments or the proudest acknowledgments I receive is about being a great father, right? I think that's a big deal for me. And I want to be acknowledged for serving. I really do. I really want to be acknowledged for, it's good to be acknowledged for success, but I feel like.
Not but, it's and, because but well, is
and.
Kind of, yeah.
Okay. And. But serving and affecting other people's lives.
You said
lives.
And but.
Nope. Serving other people's, affecting other people's lives, right? Because for me, you know, I'm a leader. And leaders create leaders, and leaders help people create better lives for themselves.
Yes.
Right? I'm not a manager. I'm not a boss. I'm a leader, right? Hmm. Leader means I expect at some point for you to lead with me, beside me, not always be behind me, right? So, and having that type of mindset, then I'm genuinely interested in people achieving the highest levels of whatever it is, if it's success or in their career, whatever it is. I just want people to be the best at what they want to do or what they want or what their interest is. If you want to be like, so, you know, if you want to be the best teacher in the world, I want you to strive to be the best teacher in the world. It's not about how much money you make. It's not about your house, your cars, right? Those, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with material things. I personally enjoy material things, right? But, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I say that because material things are what can drive you to the success that you're looking for. If you're doing it for somebody else, that's a different story. But if you're doing it for yourself, because those are goals or those are milestones for you, or that's what drives you to be able to, you know, maybe your goal is, I want to feed 1,000 homeless people every year. Well, to do that, then you have to be successful. And what's driving you to that success, right? It might be a material thing, or maybe it's just the ability to buy those 1,000 meals. I don't know what it is, but I never judge anybody for what drives them for success. And I hate when people, you know, prejudge me for, you know, whatever reason, because I like my fashion and I like cars and those different things.
There's definitely like, 10, 12 levels of what motivates you. One is love. Two, like, I don't know if it's two, but I definitely know the emotion of love drives someone to get into action. Mm-hmm. Material gain.
Material gain.
Awards, like being recognized.
But
that's something that
some people care about.
I want an award.
Yeah, I don't really care about awards.
But that's just a section of what motivates you.
Mm-hmm. And now, I would never judge someone who does care about awards.
No, and it's easier to, I would say, make it nothing. Mm-hmm. Like, yes, I like that, but like, are we putting extra meaning onto this? Right. Like, you know, because I like that, are we putting extra meaning onto it? Like, that's what motivates me, and that's what fuels my tank.
Well, that's just like, I always tell people, you know, I want to be rich, but not famous. You know, awards are more for fame, right? Like, I see people post awards online sometimes, and to me, my father, even when I used to play sports when I was a kid, baseball and football and all that stuff, and you get trophies. And one time I remember I didn't get a trophy because I didn't get like MVP or whatever it was or whatever award. I wanted some award and I didn't get it. And I remember my father said, you know, the trophy or the award, that don't make you because you're supposed to do that. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't even know why you're getting an award for something you were supposed to do anyway. You know, I expect you to be, you should expect to be the best player. You should expect to perform. You should expect to succeed. So does a piece of a metal or a piece of paper drive you to that or what you were supposed to do anyway? So that's kind of how I've always been. Supposed to do it anyway. I like one of my favorite football players growing up was Barry Sanders. And they always asked him, like, why don't you ever celebrate when you score a touchdown? He was like, because I was always taught to act like I've been there before. He just handed the ball to the referee. No celebration, no dancing, no raising the roof, no nothing. He said, I scored touchdowns before, and I was always taught to act like I've been there before. You know, first time he ever scored, that's just how it was. So, thoughts, perspective, experiences. We have real mastermind conversations on the Real Estate Evolved podcast.
I like what you said about act like I've been there before, mm-hmm. and that brings me back to our text messages. Like, I am is just a way of being, and you be that way. Like, it's definitely like a alignment.
It's being. It is. It is.
And it takes something.
It does. It takes energy. Believe it or not, I think people need to realize that everything in life requires energy, and energy comes in the form of work, comes in the form of mind power, because let's face it, somebody can wake up and just be like, no. Let me just get my day started. I ain't thinking about no I am possibility, nothing. I don't even feel like put no thought into that. Let me just get my day.
It's good for us that we still have structures, mm-hmm. and like schedules, you know, things planned out. So that works for my life as a new agent, like, mm-hmm. to still create a schedule for yourself.
Right.
Like lead generation, gym time, showings, like just... Yeah. Put that in your calendar and stick to that schedule.
I think everybody should have accountability partners. At least one.
Helpful.
At least one, right? At least one account. I mean, look.
So for newer agents, that's not like on a team that they feel like they got somebody there, mm-hmm. to, you know, hold their hand and they can ask all the silly questions.
Find somebody look, we live in an age of instant communication. Find somebody you can text every day, at least once a day. With those questions, or somebody that can hold you accountable to your affirmations, can hold you accountable to your goals.
What helps me is that it's not about me. That if you stepping out and talking to them, and I'd be like, you know what, I'm not really having a good day, like, you know, whatever. But it's really about my community. And mm-hmm. if you walked into the building and I was like that, but you still needed me, like at that point, I would just get over what was on my mind to be with you at that moment.
Right.
And I think that that connection makes people feel better, and maybe they may not last.
Right.
And then they start referring you business later down.
Mm,
it's
win-win.
But I was nice to
you. Yeah, big wins. Wins everywhere.
So that helps. Just being able to reach out to people.
Yeah, I mean, because even the most accountable people, they probably are so accountable because they have accountability partners or just people in their circle that can hold them accountable. And trust me, if you are a new agent, reach out to people, you know, me and Javada, whoever. Like, look, there's people out there that will help you be accountable because you're also helping us
and
be accountable.
And it doesn't matter our brokerage. That,
No, that's a big misconception, I think.
No.
Any agents that make a big deal about that, they're probably old school and they're lost in the sauce, because these days, you know, I preach this a lot. I preach this a lot. I say, look, if I'm a new agent, you want to be great at building relationships with other agents, right? Yeah. If I'm a new agent, or if I'm an agent, I want, when people see my listings, I don't care what brokerage you're from, I want you to be very excited to bring a client to my listing. And on the other side, if I represent a buyer and you see my offer come in, maybe, I want you to be very excited.
I think
that
about it.
Kenyon Hunter is bringing that client because you're so excited to work with me because of our relationship. Relationships are key. Relationships are key.
Definitely.
Absolutely. All right. So here, now we're going to move on. Two questions that all guests
have. Wait, I didn't get to acknowledge you for the things that you wanted to be acknowledged for.
Oh, did I tell you what I wanted to be acknowledged for?
Yeah, you told me.
Oh, so you're going to nominate? Okay, let's back up.
Kenyon.
Okay, Kenyon. It's French.
Kenyon.
It's not French, but whatever.
KK. Kenny.
Don't call me Kenny. That sounds like a drunk name.
Ken
works. That's my name for, you know, when I'm out, I'm not around my people.
I got that.
Hey, Ken Hunter, you got it?
Ken, I want to acknowledge you for being a leader.
Thank you.
I want to acknowledge you for being a great father.
Thank you.
I want to acknowledge you for shifting the ability in what people hear in real estate. You're providing quality, you know, product to enhance the listeners, to empower the listeners. I love your vitamin K. It's consistent. It's there for me. Like, I'm at the point where, like, I expect it.
Okay. All right.
So,
Monday through Friday. I do skip it on weekends.
And just your branding is, like, is there for me. Is there for me. So I want to acknowledge you for uplifting me in the morning.
Thank you.
Oh, sometimes, my gosh. That means a lot. You know, I'm not, sometimes when I'm not here for it.
Okay.
So I acknowledge you for that.
Man, I appreciate that. That means a lot. See, this is what, it feels amazing. Like, my day is going to be like cloud nine, because that's what I want. That is like, you know,
I want someone to tell me that I'm doing a great job.
You do want that, but you want to know you're impacting people.
Right.
It's impact. Even when I was in corporate America, the one thing, and I don't know if corporate America actually uses it in the right terms, because to me, impact is making sure in corporate America is making sure our shareholders are making money, where real impact is the person, not their output. Right. I feel like in corporate America, it's impact to them is output, but not the person, because you can be making an impact, but if it doesn't produce output, then guess what? You'll still be a part of the layoffs, even though you got a family to feed and you got to go home and tell your wife, I've been at this company for 30 years, and I was making an impact, but it didn't equal the output that they wanted according to their shareholders. So next quarter, I'm looking for a new job, right? So real impact is, how do you really affect people? How do you help people? How do you help people that might not have wanted to get up excited, and they hear you, or they read something you wrote, or just remember something you said, and they get their ass up and get excited for the day, right? They seize that day, because they know that if you woke up, the Lord woke you up for a reason. He's not done with you. He got some work for you to do today.
And then you can be a possibility of adventure.
You can be the possibility of adventure. You can venture out from Philadelphia and get on the Patco and come to New Jersey.
Real quick, one time.
You know what I'm saying? Back. You can do that. That means a lot. I really appreciate that, Javada.
Nah,
I really
it was
do.
Fun.
I think that
I need to, you know, get out my box.
Yeah. But I appreciate that, like, the acknowledgement. And I think that that's another thing that people
could
acknowledge. Acknowledge people.
Yes.
If you see somebody out there doing something.
You gave me all the checkpoints. Like, being a great father, like, that would feel nice to hear. And it feels great. And some people, you may not know, like, what you want to be acknowledged for. Like, your style, you ain't say that. You said, like, some, like, truthful stuff, which made it easier to be completely truthful with you. Like, those were, like, your core, like, this is what feels good to me. Thank you.
It does. I think that, I think my style comes from feeling good, too.
Yeah.
I tell people that, like, look, I don't really think about it. I'm not trying to be, you know, this fashion icon. I like being a fashion icon, but I'm not trying to be. But I just feel good, and that's how, when I get dressed, I just feel good getting dressed.
I like your red. We like did this, red today.
Like little red vibes, kind of like, this is like, what red is this, though? This is called chambray. Oh, like a whatever.
You got me.
Yeah, it's one of those joints.
I have on salmon.
Salmon. This is kind of salmon-y.
And you got the beet red.
Beet red headphones on. Red's my favorite color, by the way.
I had a dream about red last night.
So you wore red.
Yes, I wore red.
There you go. I like it. Dig it. Y'all heard the hand clap. Yeah, that means a lot. I mean, it's just impact. Just make an impact. Tell people, acknowledge people. I don't think people do that enough, especially here in the Northeast.
I don't know. Yeah.
Acknowledge people. And now, look.
If I would have never asked you that question, you would have just, like, you got to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's asking, like, different questions, you know, kind of.
And I'm telling you, acknowledge people is a great source of power. And you're giving them power. Yeah. You're empowering them. So if you have a goal to empower somebody, acknowledge people. Just another task you walk away from today is, when you listen to this podcast, you see somebody that, go acknowledge them.
You got to ask them what they want to be acknowledged for first.
Ask them what they want to be acknowledged for, and then acknowledge them.
I love that.
I love it. I think the world would be a better place.
Wait. You didn't ask me.
Javada, what would you like to be acknowledged for?
Sexy voice. I gotta write it down. I want to be acknowledged for communicating, like getting in contact. I want to be acknowledged for stepping out of the side of the box, just like the mental box, and just continue to like, you know, shape my mind, and taking action on my goals. And staying true to myself.
Staying true. Javada, I'm going to acknowledge you. I am going to acknowledge you for, you met me with Genevieve, and you instantly started communicating with me within probably 24 to 48 hours. So I acknowledge your ability to communicate and the efforts you make to continue to communicate with the people. I see it on your social media. You communicate with me personally. I see how you communicate with Genevieve, our mutual friend. Shout out to Genevieve.
Thank you.
See Genevieve tomorrow at KW's Education Day. So that should be good.
Yes, I'm going to go.
I acknowledge you for that. I acknowledge you for always being out the box. The penny for your thoughts is out the box. I mean, look, most people live in this digital age where they feel like Facebook and just social media or sending a blast text is the way, is the way to connect with people.
Yeah.
But you stayed out the box, right? I've never seen these types of print materials before. I acknowledge you for staying out the box. More to that, I acknowledge you for taking action. The toughest challenge in life for people is, you know, think about, you know, in today's world, it's all about, you know, you got to think about what we bring about. The law of attraction. I always say the law of attraction, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can think about it, but if you don't take action, nothing's going to happen.
Right.
You can have all the great thoughts in the world about being, you know, having the perfect body, but if you don't eat right or go to the gym, it's not happening.
I got that.
You have to take action, right? You have to exercise. You got to go for walks. You got to meditate, do yoga. You have to eat right. You got to cut out all the bad stuff, right? And that's the only way you're going to have that perfect body. Well, depending on what you consider, some people might think round is perfect, right?
Yes.
So
yes,
whatever
amen.
Works for you. But even that, you got to take action. You want to stay round, you better eat.
Yes.
You better eat a lot, right? So I acknowledge you for taking action because you're doing things and you're approaching people and you're making a difference in the communities that you're serving. That's taking action. And then you're staying true, right? So this is all about what you've decided to do. And look, in a world of shifting theories, ideologies, and methods, you can easily change and you're staying true to that. You've been doing this since 2013 and you're staying true to the game. And you're staying true to yourself, which is number one, right? Staying true to yourself. So I acknowledge you for these things. I appreciate you.
And thank you.
And I bet that people listening are going to appreciate this too.
Thank you so much.
And they will take these aww. Acknowledgments and maybe incorporate them to their own lives in one way or the other. Right?
You want to give me a hug?
Seriously. Air hug from across the mics. So as we start to wrap, two questions all guests have to answer.
Yeah.
What drives you?
The future generation. I think definitely what drives me is the future generation. I kind of just want to create pieces for them, and that motivates them, that inspires them to just be that person that they see that's just like, you know, giving them energy.
What inspires you? Because that drives you, right? You're driven by the future generation, but what inspires you?
Colors, like beautiful people. People with like style.
Energy.
Like, energy.
Vibes.
Vibes. I like.
Oh, you dig the cherry blossoms? You dig cherry blossoms? You ever been to DC?
I've been to DC, but
you've never been to the Cherry Blossom Festival? Colors. I think of colors.
No, I have to do that. That's like a piece that my PR director, Gail, she like forces me to do these things. So she like encouraged me to contact you to get it in step. And she was like my accountability partner. Okay. That she was like, all right, Javada, do this. Okay, Javada, do that. And then I'm like, all right, whatever. And I said I was going to do it. And that's what, like you said, when I text you that, you know, I was thinking about you. I was like, I know. And then we set it up. Like, we made sure that it happened. So I'm definitely, like, you know, thankful for that. So I, you know, I got help that.
Okay.
Like, people around me, like, you inspire me. Like, she inspires me to just keep moving forward.
Stay inspired. Yeah. So that's key you say that. I said this at the beginning, and it's just something I repeat over and over. Only quality people, right? Les Brown says that a lot. You have to keep quality people around in your circle. You have to inventory your associations. Keep people in your circle that inspire you, that drive you. Keep people in your, you know, associations that are people that are either share a mindset or they're getting to where you want to. You're going to. You have a similar destination, or they're already at that destination.
Right.
Right. Never be the smartest person in the room. Never be the most successful person in the room. Don't always, you know, have conversation with people that you already know what they're going to say. Why don't you talk to people that you can learn something from?
And go on, like, coffee dates.
Yeah.
Like, I'm starting to really like these. Like, just the energy from, like, I had a coffee date with a guy I closed in, like, 2015. Mm-hmm. Like, and just, he's a developer in, like, Murraytown. So just getting that, some of that face-to-face time.
Yeah.
It's helpful. And it, you know, they keep you on, you stay on their mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I'm programmed in there.
I do like that.
I like that.
I like that a lot. You know what I'm saying? Keep that going. So
I smiled a little bit, sure.
Yeah, you got to do what you got to do.
You
got to do what you got to do. So tell me, we have a little Q&A for, you get to ask me any question that you think the listeners might want to hear. Or just something that may be intriguing or knowledgeable. Okay. So this is your moment.
It's my moment.
To ask me.
I can't wait.
Now you can ask me a question, any question, and I get to drop some insight or knowledge or mind share, whatever you want to call it.
Anything.
Anything.
Where did you meet your wife?
Oh, God, it went personal. The gym.
I was thinking about it the whole ride over here.
The gym. Yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah, the gym. What better way to meet somebody, right? You're working on your health. They're working on their health. And
aww.
We was working on our health. Now, can I tell a funny story?
Tell me.
All right. So I met her at the gym, right? I tell the story to everybody, and she always turns red. You know what machine she was on?
No.
The hip squats. The hip abductor. The
I was gonna going to say in that. And out. Yeah,
so I walked up, and she was going in and out. Talk about big balls, right? That's when I walked up and she was like, hi. I'm like, yeah, you know, I didn't mean to disturb your workout, but
I was going in and out while you was going in and out. So.
I see what you can do, and I'm just going, you know what I'm saying? And look, we should go out. And that's how it was.
In and out.
That's how it was. She was doing the in and out machine.
I like that. That's great.
How crazy was that?
That is so great. That is a good machine.
Yeah, it's a good machine.
Did they put it at the top of the steps?
No.
Oh.
I wish. That would have been funny.
Right. No. Oh, my God. Everything's on display. Never mind. That Everything. Wasn't a good question.
I like telling that story, actually.
Like, that would just make people use the steps and, like, no, right. This is an exercise.
Oh, just my gosh. Yeah. They were like, yo, I just went around the steps because they had the hip abductor right.
at the top of the steps.
And shorty that was on it. Yeah, look. I ended up being in the gym for 3 hours.
Hurry up. I want to go faster. You know what I'm Hurry up. Nah, that's great.
Got to ask me any question, and you pick that one. I just dropped Jules. So now, look, fellas, don't be afraid to approach a woman at the gym.
Yeah.
There you go. Mm-hmm. All right, so wrapping up, how do people connect with you? Contact info, social media.
Instagram,
how do you connect with Javada?
Javada _B_Hill. Javada Hill. I'm on Google. Do you do Google reviews?
I don't.
Come on.
Should I?
Yes.
All right.
Google me, baby. You know.
So do you have clients give you Google reviews?
Yes. Man, it's easy through their Google email.
Oh, all
set
right.
that up, dog. Because I'm going to Google you, and I want all the.
I
want to
be Googleable. I want to be Googleable. I do want to be Googleable. I want Wikipedia one day.
Yeah, for sure.
And Googleable and Wikipedia.
I want my name to be on the street lamp, like the street light, like Boulevard, or just okay. The whole, like, just change the whole block name.
All right. I dig it.
And I want like a Louisiana going away, like a block party, like with the horses out and the drums out. Like, that's how I want to go.
Okay. I dig it. I definitely dig it. So with that said, we had an amazing podcast. I hope y'all enjoyed it.
Yes. You know, we had fun.
Yeah, we had fun. You have to come back again.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Because I want to, definitely. You know, I hope we're reaching the people and doing good things. Closing thoughts, closing remarks. I like to give the people something. And Ben, I have Javada here.
Yes.
And we talked about affirmations. We're going to talk about, let's see, affirmations. How to stay on top of things. How to keep yourself first. I'm going to say this. We don't have the option of turning away from the future, but we do have the option to create it. Y'all think about that. And we'll see you next time. Hope y'all enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Y'all know how to reach Javada now. Y'all got her info. Y'all know how to reach me, Kenyon, at evolutionavgroup.com. And I am at realestateagent007 on Instagram.
Yes.
Send your questions, feedback. You know, let us know how we can help you.
Yeah.
Become a part of our circle in the morning. We'll tell you what we're the possibility of. You tell what you are and get your day started. Just reach out to us. If you don't have a mentor, you don't have a person, you don't have a team or somebody to reach out to, you know, find it. And, you know, we're here for you. We'll link you up with some good people, too. And yeah. We can do that. So we appreciate you, Javada. I appreciate you. Thank you.
I appreciate you, too.
Thank you. Come back to the show again, please.
Thank you.
Let's do this more. Let's go out with a little, let's talk. Life is good, right? Now throw your hands up in the sky.